hello everyone. Actually, the title was The Many Ways of Invoking a Method, but it was kind of too long, so I just... It's not on? Okay, again, testing. Can somebody hear me? Nobody is reacting, so nobody can hear me.
Yes.
Okay, now I see reactions. So, okay, what I was saying, actually the title is The Many Ways of Invoking a Method. I shortened the title a little bit to bytecode hands-on because I'm intending not to show a lot of slides. I have actually only 3 slides prepared for this. One is the title slide. So I will try to show you actually really working approaches here for how I work with bytecode. And that means if you are expecting here now to sit back and get this look at the slides and figure out what is happening, sorry, you will have to pay attention. You will not have the luxury of leaning back and not paying attention and then looking occasionally on the slides and figuring out what happened, because it will be too late then. Okay. So just so you know who I am, I was introduced here correctly as Jochen Theodoro, and I'm working at Karakun in Switzerland, and I was involved with Groovy for a long time already, decades, almost. Damn it. And that's the PDF version that I cannot change. Okay. Okay, you have to... See, that's 2004, not 14. I'm thinking I'm 10 years younger somehow. I don't know why somebody would want to be 10 years younger. So, and I made myself a bit the name of doing the complicated stuff, mostly handling the verification error messages from stupid JVM not accepting the bytecode I wrote. I will not show many of them because those messages don't have really a lot of readable value in them. They are just, you have to look at the bytecode to understand what this message actually means, so I concentrate on the bytecode. And to understand what we will see, I will first give a little explanation of some of the fundamentals. So the JVM is a stack-based machine. That means it will push and pop and use operands that are in a kind of stack, which I call the operand stack. We have a lot of instructions for loading and storing, because storing where, you ask, if there is a stack. Well, there are also something like slots where you can store things. And there are methods you can invoke, of course, and fields you can set. So you have different operations with different effects. And then you may have something like this here. On the left side, I present bytecode in a little bit readable version. In the middle is something that is named stack that I will explain in a moment. On the right side are some explanations. So the idea of this code here is, it's totally random and doesn't make any sense. It's just to show some effects, some initial instructions, just to get the first hands-on feeling of this. So we start with an empty stack, and then we do an operation called A load zero. If you decompile Java bytecode, you will see this very often, because this is usually how you load this in a virtual method. If you're in a static method, by the way, A load zero will not be this. It will be the slot zero. Strange, or not. I mean, they could have started with one, even a static method. So slot zero is automatically this in a virtual method, and in a static method, it's the first parameter. So one is accordingly, in a virtual method, the first parameter, and in a static method, the second. Great. Cost $2 or $3, I think. So that means you do A load zero, and we assume we are in a virtual method, so you are loading this on the stack. Why do I write this? Because the stack is actually typed. The JVM doesn't do a lot of typing internally. Most of the typing is done by the compiler. But all the object references and primitives, they have a certain type. So you have to follow a little bit, a few simple rules. You always have the check cast operation to change an element to whatever you want, and then it may fail or may not fail with a class cast exception that you surely have seen before in Java, even with generics. Oh, I found my second mistake in the slides. Good. Load. Load. That should be load. So, and then next instruction you see here is an I load one. So we have A load and I load. But I don't load, it's the JVM, and it's loading an integer, a primitive integer. All object references, that includes the object integer, the wrapper type, are loaded with an A load from a slot, and integers are loaded with an I load. Of course, that means, if you think about it, there are lots of more primitive types. There's longs, so you have an L load. There's doubles, so you have a D load. With a D, not a DE. And then there is float, so you have an F load. And there is short, byte, character that are loaded with I load. Makes total sense. And there's Boolean, which is also I load. Yes, so zero means false, one means true. Any other value, I don't know. I haven't actually tested, I must say. So in this example, we load this, then we load an integer, which is most likely the first parameter of our method, or something we stored as a local variable, because parameters and local variables are kind of the same at this level. Then the difference is local variables I first have to push, and parameters are already loaded. Because you have like an endless list of slots, well, I think it's 255, but let's say it's an endless list, and then you can push in an unused slot and load from it. And if it was an A push, then you push a certain type, and an A load will give you something back of this type. If you use a different type, you're in trouble. Then the JVM may or may not like it. Depending on the version, it may complain or may not complain. That's also bugs I had before. So in this example, then I load this. Then let's say I load the first parameter of our virtual method. And let's say I load from 10 slot some by name unknown local variable which is of some unspecified type t. And then I'm going to invoke a method. It's a virtual method invocation. Remember virtual, that's those with the inheritance. I'm invoking this method on the class my class. But I'm not invoking virtual methods on classes. I'm invoking virtual methods on instances. So there has to be a relation to what I ever loaded before. But let's see. So there's then you see here a dot and then method. Method is the name of the method. I was very creative and called it method. And then I get the round brackets, and then there's an I. Then there's a strange L, then something with Java lang string and a semicolon and then a set. What? So this is most likely not going to work, because what this is actually doing is it's popping off the stack, the operands for my method of invocation. This is an invocation taking two parameters, arguments. The one is an integer, the I, and the next one is a string. On my stack, I have a T. That's not a string. That may or may not cause a problem. You may or may not get a verification error. Newer JVMs tend to check this and consistently give verification errors and such things, but I had all kinds of effects before, so I'm not sure. On the other hand, you have seen I'm working on those things 4+ years, 14 years, 15 years actually, if you count my time before, and I really had all kinds of effects with different JVMs, or especially with different vendors, so this may be checked or may not be checked. It should be checked. If it's not be checked, it's a bug. But the JVM is far from free from bugs. So now we have established, we are calling a method called method with two arguments. So we are going, in my example here, I tend to use a different way of writing a stack because the oldest element is on the left, the youngest one is on the right. So we are going to pop the things from right. So T should be actually a string. I is the integer that fits. And the receiver of the method is this. So this is my class, most likely. And I'm calling a method on this, that is called method, with two arguments. And it is returning a set. Who has any idea what set could be? Anyone? Would anyone believe me if this is Boolean? Makes perfect sense. I mean, you have I, L, D, F, and Z. Okay. There's a story behind that that I don't know, but I know there's a story behind this and a certain reason why it's a set. Maybe you can read this in the specification, which, by the way, I have linked here. That's the Java Virtual Machine specification. If you're doing bytecode, this is kind of your Bible. I will show you parts of this later, especially of chapter 6, which has all the instructions and the descriptions of how they are working. So our stack had three elements on it. We are calling something that is popping off three elements, so we end up with an empty. No, that's wrong. We are leaving set, so we are leaving a Boolean. So in this example here, I do an istore 11. I store in slot 11 the Boolean, which is kind of like an integer somehow. And then, just as another awkward example, I may deload 2 here. And then LL load 4. So I already mentioned those. So why is it awkward? Because double and long use 2 slots. Integer uses 1 slot. Double and long are the only ones that are using 2 slots. Object references also take 1 slot. So that means if your method is taking two parameters, a static method, and the first one is an integer and the second one is an integer, you have slot one and slot zero and slot one. If your first parameter of your static method is a double and the next one is an int, your first slot is zero, your next slot is two. Another $4, I think, involved in this, in handling not the number of slots correctly over the last 15 years. And then there's a swap instruction in the JVM bytecode, because you know sometimes you get things in the wrong order. You have to shovel them around. You can duplicate them with a dup. You can move them around with a dup x. But because you have different categories of variables of using one or two slots, you have dup 2x, you have dup x2, and you have dup the normal dup, and you have dup 2x2. And I every time have to look up what they do, especially if I'm using those in combination with category one slots, which is possible, then you're handling like four different variables at the same time, and it's going to be chaos. I really have to be carefully reading the documentation. But here's an example of how I can, for example, simulate a swap, because we have a swap for category one, but we don't have one for category two. So if you want to swap an object reference and an integer, you can just write swap. If you want to swap two doubles, you have to do something like this here, the dup x, dup 2x2 and pop 2. And it gets really nice if you want to swap, for example, a double in an int or an int in a double, because then it's different. I have a whole abstraction of swap in the bytecode helper in Groovy for this kind of stuff. So who is already totally overloaded and has no idea what I'm talking about so far? Only one. Okay, then I failed. So. Then I would suggest not looking at this. So just make a simple hello world public class hello world, just ordinary plain Java, arbitrarily formatted with German capitalization. And I wrote it correctly, except this. Cool. Ah, of course, I didn't. Yeah, that's static void main. When you do so much Groovy, you forget you have to write a proper main method. Oh, two voids. Public, and if you don't keep with the order of the modifiers, you may try two voids. Let's compile again. Thanks for the help. Yeah, so this is a hello world. And if I do this, I'm looking at the bytecode of this. It's like a decompiled version, because, I mean, if I look at the compiled version, I see some strings, but that's not really helpful. So I have a little tool that gives me information about what this method is doing in bytecode. And then you see things like the version of the compiler, 52 is for Java 8, 51 would be Java 7, 53 is, I think, Java 9, and so on. You see, it has an init method. That's the constructor. You see, it has my main method. You see some line number information. You see some strange max stack and max locals, and some strange L0 and L1s. So max stack is information I have to give the JVM to know how many places for the stack it has to allocate. It's roughly equal to the maximum number of local and temporary variables you are going to have in bytecode. So in Java, if you are having three parameters and two local variables, you are most likely to have a max stack of 5 or 6, depending if it's a static method or not. As you can, and then there's also max locals, the number of local variables. Those L0 and L1, they are markers used by the library I'm using, which is ASM from Object Web, I think. And we are using ASM to produce our bytecode, and I'm also using it to read and check or provide other information with it. Then I have another command, ASMify. I called it, which does something like this. This is what you would have to write using the API of ASM to produce this kind of code. So looking at tools is boring if you have no idea what they do, how they are used. And so it's very simple. There is an ASMifier class. I'm using the jar-jarred version, which is coming with the distribution because I'm depending on an unpacked version of Groovy. If you are using ASM directly, then you are, of course, using a slightly different package, which is, I think, org.objectweb.asm.util and such. And I'm making use of the star import because this tool wants to load classes from the class path. If you are not taking care of it. And the trace class tool is the textifier from the same library. Very similar. So you can take a look at those. You can use them. You can bind them into. They have a visitor structure. If you look at ASMify, you see you're creating a method visitor, which is used by a class writer, which was a class visitor in the past. And you have an annotation visitor. You have a field visitor. And no, I don't. Yeah, and then you have. Then you have a way at the end to create a byte array that is actually containing your bytecode. So all those things wouldn't be fun if we wouldn't do the same in Groovy. So hello world, Groovy C, that's a Groovy compiler. Don't make it so small. Because the script was run.groovy, the class is run.class. And holy moly, there's a lot of stuff in this class. Because, first of all, since this is a script, it extends Groovy lang script. You will notice This is not using the dot annotation for classes that you are used to. This is using slashes. And then you see here, for example, a field which is containing information we are using for the meta object protocol. And you notice it uses slashes, but enclosed by L and semicolon. That's something you have to get used to, and it's really annoying. If it's low, because here, you know, why isn't it here with an L and a semicolon? I mean, why two different things? I have no idea. So we can tell now this field called $StaticClassInfo. By the way, you can use identifiers that are not valid in the Java language. Has the type of some internal class of Groovy, which is class info. And this here is a Boolean, if you remember, set Boolean. And there are, this one at least is synthetic, for example, which is usually used to indicate this is generated by the compiler. So here you have something similar. For our reference. And if you look at this here, the init, you may remember from Java, the first thing you have to do is call super. Actually, you can write a lot of bytecode before calling super. And super, this is super. This is the call super with an invoke special. And you remember, a load 0 is loading this. And now you will maybe think, wait, I'm calling super with this, and is my this then initialized, or what is this? And I can tell you, this is a special this. This is not the initialized this. If you try to invoke methods on this, the JVM is going to kick you and giving very strange error messages, the strangest ones I have ever seen. And you should not do this. Avoid it, please. First do the invoke special, then you can use the real this to invoke methods on virtual methods. Static methods you can invoke, like in Java. Java is forcing you to do it in the parameter part of the super call. You don't have a parameter part here, so you can do all kinds of things here. You can swap things on the stack. You can call all kinds of static methods. You can call instance methods of other objects as much as you want. You can do even big table switches in here, which we are actually doing to select the proper super constructor in some cases for overloads. So you can do a lot of things here. But if you are going to work on this, there has to be the invoke special first. If you look here, you will see there is a local variable called this of type run. Remember, our class is called run, just lowercase because it's Groovy, it's not Java. And this goes from L0 to L1, which means it's visible in this area as a variable named this. And what the 0 is, I don't remember anymore. Ah, the frame, you're right. Thank you very much. That's probably the frame, yes. I wish later show more. Probably the time is not enough to show something about frames. Here we have another example of local variables. Again, the this valid from L0 to L1. And there's a variable called context, which is, it's not the frame, it's the slot. It's the slot. It's slot 0. And the context is slot 1. Because this method here takes a binding. It's the first parameter. So the first parameter is in the can be used from the first slot in a virtual method, and the constructor is kind of a virtual method. It's not a static method, but more because you created this here. You with this together, you created this because this one here is, for example, loading the uninitialized this. It's loading the first parameter and then doing the super call. It's delegating the binding to the superclass constructor. And then, going a bit more down, we have to look a bit for where is our hello world. Somebody spotting hello world? I mean, here is a main method with a var args modifier. Yeah, that var args modifier, you may remember, Java says, the last parameter may be a var args one, variable arity. Effectively, it's an array. And I make a modifier on the method to say, this one, if the last one is an array, it's a var args. If the last one isn't an array, it's strictly a bytecode error. You may or may not get a verification error for this. If you forget it, if you use it and it's not an array. So, why is the hello world not here? No, I really have to look. Where's my hello world? Ah, it's in the run, of course. See, now I was in the static main method of Java looking, and it's the run method because it's a script. Thank you very much. So we have some instructions an instruction called LDC, which is a kind of load constant. With LDC, you can load integers, you can load doubles, or if you load floats, I think you have to convert them first. I'm not sure. I would have to look this up. But integers you can load, in string you can load. I think method references you can load, which is for dynamic invocation, basically. And class references you can load with that. So we load the string hello world here. And then we go in some internal stuff that does dynamic dispatching. And we have some frame stuff here, but I think I will skip that. But okay. And then the other methods is really just assisting Groovy in doing everything. So to make things a bit more interesting, can you not switch, please? So just putting it in a method will not make it very interesting, but we have our famous compile static. So if I compile this now and look at the code again, and then go to my method foo. I could have named it run. But then you see it will do things a bit differently. First of all, you will see an invoke virtual. So it's not going through the dynamic dispatch anymore. It's calling the method directly, which is a print line on script, for which I need to load this. This checkcast is actually unnecessary, but the bytecode is really full of errors. It's difficult to get all of them out. But this would be worth fixing. One less instruction, usually they don't hurt. But that code is not good. This is, by the way, a very good sign of having that code at the end of a method, because ASM is producing no operation, does nothing, and an if row which would throw an exception if there would be one, but there is none in this case. We defined a foo method, which I had with a def here in front, and because it's with a def in front, it's actually returning something. So, since I'm calling a void method print line, I'm loading here null and return null. If it would be not a void method, if I would do just system error, for example, then I would return a stream, a print stream. Doesn't really make sense, this kind of code, but it's just for illustration. And going in the right window helps too. Now you see this part is new line number 4. We are getting the static field error from system, which is a print stream, and then we return it with an A return. So now, when developing with Groovy, I usually tend to use some tests, for example, that are making use of these kinds of things. So we defined ourselves something called abstract bytecode test case. Actually, initiator for this was Guillaume. Thank you very much. Which has the nice ability of making some loose check on bytecode. I make it a bit bigger. So first, we send in a script, which can be a complete class, anything. And then we check that there is a certain bytecode sequence that is fulfilled by this. And this is more or less I starts with check. So I have, for example, a long load here, but I'm not saying which slot is used for this. But I want to ensure, for example, that I do a compare greater or equals on integers, or that I do conversion from integer to long with E to L, instead of calling, for example, a Groovy cast for this. Yes. And that I do a DMAL, which is a multiplication using double. And that I do an IAD, an integer-based addition. And that I store it as a primitive integer later. It's to avoid unboxing and to avoid doing certain operations with the runtime that could be done in the bytecode directly. So, for example, if I take this one, I modified the test a bit. Sorry, actually the code. So it prints out here the full. This is non-standard. Here's a marker here, so I know that's the end of my method. It was supposed to enclose the method, but something changed, so we are not using that. This is a long method, as you see. Has lots of bytecode in here, and there's lots of strange stuff. And there are also several invoke static methods, invoke interface to invoke methods on interfaces, which, by the way, is if you get a parameter and it's an interface, you have to use invoke interface. If you're working on an instance that implements that interface, you must use invoke virtual. Don't ask me why. I think you can use invoke interface, but it's lower by a few microseconds, maybe nanoseconds. Who knows? JVM is optimizing a lot. Okay. So let me check. Ah, yes, I wanted to show a bit of the specification. So in this chip, chapter 6.5, you have all the handful of bytecode instructions. If you consider that there are several primitive types, it's actually not that much, and you have something like subtraction, you have something like XOR, you have a shift right, yes, in different variations, a shift left, you have some like division, a remainder of a division operator, you have ORs, you have negations, multiplications, you have the normal division, you have add, you have compares of different variants. Well, there's actually two, a general variant and a three-time specific variant for the integers. And if you look at the specification, then you see something like this is a compare based on a long. It takes two values from the operand stack and puts one value back. And it says the values for this, because it's a long compare, must be of type long. And then what it does, and what values it leaves. And then you have my favorite instructions here, for example, this one, which has four forms, depending on what types the operands are. The simple form I used in the beginning is actually this one, value 2, value 1. They have to be category 2, two slots usage. And then instead of value 2, value 1, you have later value 1, value 2, value 2, value 1. So if you remove this, you have your swap, which is a pop 2, because 2 for 2 slots. And normal pop is sadly not pop 1, it's just pop for 1 slot. Okay. And what else could I show? You have, for each primitive type, you have a return. You could think, it's integer, for one for integer is for bytes, characters, booleans, and integers and shorts. Double, float, and long have their own, and of course you have an A return for the object version. If you want to create arrays, it's different. There you have all the primitive types. Let's see if I find it. Sorry. Character. So, for example, CLoad. To load a reference out of a character array, where you give first the array and second the index of the array, and you get the value that is stored in that array. Unless the array reference was null, then you get a null pointer exception, which is mentioned here. So, and the biggest problem with this bytecode stuff is it takes a lot of time to look through all this, and you spend easily hours finding something that is right in your face and you have no idea what is going wrong because it's some simple issue like your number of the slot is wrong or it's the type is not right but it's from some object and you try, for example, calling something on string and it's a different typed method and it doesn't accept this, then you get some strange exception for this. Verify error. Whenever you see a verify error in Groovy, it's a bytecode bug. And then you have to work this through, doing the example what I did, for example, here with the operand stack, working through and see what is on there and what is to be removed and what am I doing for my operations actually. Are the types right? And often they are not, then you have a problem which you have to fix. But then you found something to fix and then you're happy because then you're not searching any longer. Searching takes the longest time. But the biggest problem is really it takes a lot of time doing this. And sadly, it's a big topic and there is really here only time to scratch here and there a bit and not really explain anything, like for example the restrictions that an evoke special may call a private method, but only if the call is done from within the same class that the private method is contained in, but at the same time it's also for a constructor call and things like that. Makes no sense sometimes, the rules, they're very strange rules. Anyway, what I wanted to give you here is just a very, very, very short break-in course for bytecode and just see if you get a bit of taste of it or if you now hate me. But maybe you got a bit an overview of how those things work, where you have to look at the JVM machine specification is your best friend in understanding all those things. The ASMLib or Java P sometimes. I hate Java P because it tends not to show the information I want. So ASM is your best friend to see the things. You can compile classes in Java and decompile it with ASM and see what happens and try to mimic this. And then you get some nice results usually. Well, thank you very much. Sadly, there's no time anymore. But I have to end here. Yeah, questions, whatever. We can stop. How much pauses for the next talk? To the next talk? Yeah, okay. Then we have some time for questions. They don't have to be recorded. My sources. The tools, Maven Central. It's just the ASMLib. I only made this command line script. Yeah, it's just a script. It's really just calling the ASM class classes that are already there. So ASMIFIRE and Java P comes, since we have, so for example, Java P, minus P and whatever. And so for example, that's how Java P looks like. That is coming with the SDK. And what I don't like is it has lots of offsets here that are very confusing because you have here get static 97, which is get something from the constant pool at entry 97. You go up there, look for entry pool, and because I forgot to give a certain command line option, it's not there. That's why I don't like that. And it's written here. You are right. Thank you very much. I'm not using this tool often, as you see. And I'm missing my local variable table, and I'm missing my line numbers, and I'm missing my exception table. Actually, it's not there. And also the inner class table may be of interest if you do inner classes. You can get all those. But sometimes it's a certain combinations of command line parameters for Java P, and it's very annoying. I hate Java P. So I prefer using the ASMLib, which is also in the JDK in theory, and under I can tell you. So if you do something like this, for example, this is the Jaja one. Oh, no, I'm not finding it. Probably was there. So it's object ASM. Now I cannot prove what I claimed, but it's really in there. I don't know why it's not shown now. It's also under JDK, that's classified, Java P toolkit. This one? Ah, yes, you're right, this one is it. So in theory, you could use JDK internal org object web ASM textifier or, .util textifier to get the textifier, the one that is printing the ASM output, the decompiled bytecode. But if you are using JDK 9, you will not have access to it, of course, because of the module system that's preventing such nice things. This is an old Java 8, so it's still possible. Any more questions? So anyone who wants to get more wet feet with this, I just suggest write some Java classes, decompile them, try and understand what is there. I didn't scratch, for example, the representation of generics or frames or invoke dynamic or setting, getting static fields. There's still a lot to cover. But this would, I think, require a workshop to go all through those and talk like this is too small for that. So thank you very much, then. And have a nice conference. Farewell.